good evening, everyone. I'd like to find out everybody's name. We'll start with this young man right here in the front. Jacqueline Knorr and
Kimberly.
Kimberly, okay. And you, sir?
Michael Davis.
Michael Davis, okay. And?
Marcia Vincent.
Marcia Vincent and Dustin. Okay, let's see. Good, okay. Very good.
What was your name?
Bill.
Bill?
Bill Hughes.
Bill Hughes, okay.
Yes, sir, Michael. Yeah. Well, this evening, let's go ahead and have prayer. Father in heaven, we thank you this evening for your words. We thank you for the three angels' messages. We thank you that they are going to go to the ends of the earth, and that all the world will hear your great messages for this time. We thank you that we can have a little part in that proclamation. We pray tonight, as we study together, we pray for the Holy Spirit to teach us, to guide us as we study together. We thank you for your amazing love that you've poured out upon each one of us. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to do a little series this weekend. We're going to start this evening, and we're going to continue on in Revelation chapter 14. If you'd like to open your Bibles, that's where we're going to be throughout our meetings. Revelation 14, verses 6 through 12. Revelation 14, verses 6 through 12. The reason these verses are so important is because they come just before the harvest in Revelation 14 and verse 15, where the Bible says, "Another angel came out of the temple, crying with a loud voice to him that sat on the cloud, 'Thrust in thy sickle and reap, for the time is come for thee to reap, for the harvest of the earth is ripe.'" So the harvest, we know from Matthew chapter 13 and verse 39, what does the Bible tell us the harvest is? Matthew chapter 13 and verse 39, the Bible says, "The enemy that sowed them is the devil. The harvest is what? The end of the world." So Revelation 14 verse 15 and 16 talks about the harvest. Jesus declares in Matthew 13 that the harvest is the end of the world. So the messages of the three angels of Revelation 14, 6 to 12 are given to prepare people, to prepare you and me for the second coming of Christ. Just that simple. And these messages are given, folk, to prepare the entire world for the second coming of Christ. We read in Revelation 14 and verse 6, the Bible says, "I saw another angel fly in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach unto them that dwell on the earth, to every nation and kindred and tongue and people." So how far will these messages go, folk? They're going to go to the entire world. It says to every nation, every kindred, every tongue, every person is going to hear these three angels' messages. Now let's take a look at what they say. "Saying with a loud voice, 'Fear God and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment has come. Worship him that made heaven and earth, the sea and the fountains of waters.'" Well, folk, we're going to look at each one of those phrases. Tonight in this meeting, we're going to look at what it means to fear God and what it means to give glory to him. That's going to be the focal point of our meeting tonight. Tomorrow morning, We're going to look in the first meeting, God willing, at the hour of his judgment is come, and worship him that made heaven and earth, the sea, and the fountains of waters. We're going to take a look at those two phrases tomorrow morning in the first meeting. In the second meeting tomorrow, we're going to look at the second angel's message, which says there followed another angel saying, Babylon is fallen, is fallen. That great city, because she made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. That will be our second meeting tomorrow. Who is Babylon? How has she fallen? What's this wine of her fornication? And why does Babylon receive such bad marks in Scripture? Finally, the first meeting tomorrow afternoon, we're going to look at the third angel's message, which says, the third angel followed them, saying with a loud voice, if any man worship the beast in his image and receive his mark in his forehead or in his hand, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture into the cup of his indignation. And he shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb. The smoke of their torment ascendeth up forever and ever, and they have no rest day or night who worship the beast and his image, and whosoever receiveth the mark of his name. We're going to take a look at that in the first meeting tomorrow afternoon. What is this beast? What is the image? What is this mark that brings down the wrath of an infinitely patient, a wonderfully compassionate God? What is this mark that is so bad that it will suffer the wrath of God for all those who embrace it? And finally, here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. So these are the things we're going to be looking at over the next several meetings we'll have together. And folk, if we understand these messages and submit to the God of heaven who has given these to us, then when Jesus comes, we're going to be ready. And we're going to be able to go home to heaven with Christ and live forever and ever with him. Now, how important? Obviously, these messages are critical because they're given to prepare us for the second coming. Well, notice this statement, Signs of the Times, January 25, 1910. Spirit of Prophecy says, these three angels represent the people who accept the light of God's messages and go forth as his agents to sound the warning throughout the length and breadth of the earth. Christ declared to his followers, ye are the light of the world. To every soul that accepts Jesus, the cross of Calvary speaks, behold the worth of the soul. Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Now notice this next statement, as it relates to these three angels flying in the midst of heaven. It says this, nothing is to be permitted to hinder this work. It is the all-important work for this time, and it is to be far-reaching as eternity. You know, folk, the devil has 1,000 things in the church and out of the church to get us focused on everything but the three angels' messages. Everything but the three angels' messages. And what did Ellen White say there? Nothing is to be permitted to hinder this work. And the work she's talking about is the work of the three angels' messages. That is our work, friends. That is why we're here in this world, is to share those three angels' messages. Prophecy declares that the first angel would make his announcement to every nation, kindred, tongue, and people. The warning of the third angel, which forms a part of the same threefold message, and is the message for this time will be no less widespread. The banner on which is inscribed the commandments of God, the faith of Jesus, is to be raised aloft. The power of the first and second messages is to be intensified in the third. It is represented in the prophecy as being proclaimed with a loud voice by an angel flying in the midst of heaven. And it will command the attention of the world. Signs of the Times, January 25, 1910. Folk, did you hear what the prophet said? She didn't say the three angels' messages might get people's attention. She didn't say that the three angels' messages might be given. No. When Ellen White talked, she didn't talk in possibilities. She talked in absolutes. She said, this is what's going to happen. And friend, it's going to happen. She says the three angels' messages will command the attention of the world. How much of the world's going to hear it? All the world. How many people's attention is going to be drawn to the three angels' messages? All. Everybody. Because God will arrange events in this world so that all the world will have their attention zeroed in on those three angels' messages. Now, folks, if we're a part of, as we read in that previous statement, these three angels represent the people who accept the light of God's messages and go forth as His agents to sound the warning throughout the length and breadth of the earth. Friend, if we take that seriously, then we're going to be part of this. And God is going to so arrange events in this world, and in fact, I don't know if you noticed this week, something happened down in the cities, St. Paul, Minneapolis, here this week, that folk is triggering, and who knows how far it will go. But folk, it could trigger drawing everyone's attention to the three angels' message. You say, how's that, Bill? What happened in Minneapolis, St. Paul? Well, there was a young man that was shot by a white police officer. Did you hear about that? He was a black man, had a good reputation down there. He worked in a school system. He was shot. I don't know all the details, but folk, a lot of people got upset all over this country. And last night in Dallas, Texas, two snipers killed five police officers, wounded several others, plus other people. Now, folk, if this continues, there could be a shutdown of government in this. There could be martial law in the United States. And, folk, if there's martial law, it's going to be a restriction of our freedoms as Americans. And, folk, as we're going to see tomorrow, that connects right in with the third angel's message. So the very events that are going on as we sit in this quiet place this evening, the very events going on out in our world, folk, could bring the attention of the world to the first, second, and third angels' messages. Could happen. In this day, God has called His church, as He called ancient Israel, to stand as a light in the earth. Now notice the word she uses to describe, by the mighty cleaver of truth, the messages of the first, second, and third angels, He has separated a people from the churches and from the world to bring them into a sacred nearness to Himself. So folk, these three messages are a very special privilege to know and to understand and to share. It says God uses them to bring his people into a sacred nearness to himself. He has made them the depositories of his law, has committed to them the great truths of prophecy for this time. Like the holy oracles committed to ancient Israel, these are a sacred trust to be communicated to the world. Do you notice those words, friend? A sacred trust. God has entrusted to you and to me this treasure as a sacred trust. And I guess the question we've got to ask ourselves tonight is, what are we doing with this sacred trust that God has given to us? Are we distracted on something else? Are we focusing on other things? Or are we focused on those messages and sharing them with the world? Now, an interesting word that Ellen White used, she called the three angels' messages the mighty cleaver of truth. You know, when I first read that, I thought, what in the world is a cleaver? Well, I had an idea that it was some kind of a knife. So I went to my local grocery store, and I went back into the meat area, and I asked the butcher there, I said, tell me, can you show me a cleaver? Ed, that thing was about this long. He had different ones. They were all hanging up on his wall. But the one I remember, it was about this long. It was about this thick. I mean, it was a good inch and a half thick. And I said, tell me, what do you do with that? He said, we'll lay out a carcass of some animal, probably a cow, pig. He said, but we'll lay it out on the table. And he said, we'll get a big cleaver. And he said, we will just go, pow, like that. And I said, when you bring that cleaver down, sir, what happens? He said, everything flies. He said, it either goes this way or it goes this way. But there's nothing left when the cleaver falls. Now, folks, that's what Ellen White called the three angels' messages. Have you ever wondered why these messages, they divide people? That's what they do. They divide people because some people love them and want to hold on to them because they recognize they're a sacred trust. And others look at them and say, oh, they're not that big of a deal. I want to be like all the other churches and I want to be just like the world. And so there's a split. And folk, that's the very nature of the three angels' messages. They're a cleaver. They split, they divide people, they split families. Some go this way, some go that way. It's the very nature of the three angels' messages. The 14th chapter of Revelation outlines the work that is to be done by the people of God just before the second advent of our Savior. So do we want to be recognized as the people of God? If we do, then we're taking the sacred trust of the three angels' messages and we're doing everything we can to share those messages. There's God's people. You want to know if you're one of God's people? If you are, then you're sharing the three angels' messages with as many people as you can. If we're sharing something else, are we God's people? We're not, are we, Kimberly? It's really pretty simple, isn't it? It's very, very simple. If I've gotten sidetracked and I'm not sharing the three angels' messages with the world, then I'm not one of God's people. I might be a blinded child of God. I might be a distracted child of God. But folks, God wants us to get our focus back where it's supposed to be. Back where it's supposed to be. Because the people of God are sharing those three messages. They're representatives which must go to all the inhabitants of the world, and they will go to all the inhabitants of the world. Well, let's take a look now. Revelation 14, we know it's the everlasting gospel, so it's going to exalt Jesus Christ. He is the gospel. And the very first phrase was, fear God. Well, what does it mean to fear God? Does it mean to shake? Does it mean to be scared? Does it mean to feel like I can't approach God because he might zap me? Is that what it means to fear? Well, no. The Bible's very clear. The Bible is very clear what fearing God entails. Job 28:28 says this. Unto man he said, behold, the fear of the Lord. Okay, here's our phrase now. Fearing God, or fearing the Lord. The fear of the Lord is wisdom, to depart from evil is understanding. Well, wisdom and understanding are the same thing. This is Hebrew poetry. Wisdom and understanding are the same thing. So fearing God and departing from evil are the same thing. See how that works? Wisdom, understanding, the same. Fear God and departing from evil, the same thing as well. So to fear God is to recognize his presence wherever we are, and when the devil attacks us, to say, Lord, I want to hold your hand. I want to trust you to give me power to do what's right. That's fearing God. It's choosing him instead of sin. Proverbs 8:13. Notice what the wise king had to say. The fear of the Lord. Okay, here's our words again to fear God. Fear the Lord. What is that? The fear of the Lord is to hate evil. Pride, arrogancy, the evil way, the forward mouth, do I hate. So we see the same concept in both verses. Fearing God, departing from evil. Fearing God is hating evil. Very simple. Very simple. Psalms 112 verse 1. Notice what Psalms 112 verse 1 says. Praise ye the Lord. Blessed is the man that feareth the Lord. Well, there's our phrase again, right? Fearing the Lord. Okay, what does it mean? That delighteth greatly in his commandments. So a person that fears God delights in God's commandments. Okay? Ecclesiastes 12, verse 13. Let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Fear God. Oh, well, there's our phrase again. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. So we've seen four verses now. Fearing God is departing from evil. Fearing God is to hate evil. Fearing God is to delight in his commandments. And fearing God is to keep his commandments. Okay? Very simple. The phrase fear God calls us to forsake sin and keep all of God's commandments. But how many of us can do that?
Not by ourselves.
Not by ourselves, Lenore. Naturally speaking, We want to do wrong. We have a carnal nature that wants to do wrong things. It's impossible for a person to do God's commandments, to obey God's commandments. That's impossible for a human being to do by himself. It's impossible. It behooves us to look outside of ourselves for someone to help us. And the Bible reveals somebody who will help us in our battle with sin and will enable and empower us to obey his commandments. The Bible says in Romans 8, 3 and 4, for what the law could not do in that it was weak through the flesh. See, nobody kept God's law. So it was weak through the flesh. So what did God do? God sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh and for sin, condemned sin in the flesh. Now, what does that simply mean? Nobody had ever kept God's law. So Jesus said, I will go down, and by trusting in your power, Father, I will walk in your commandments. And I will do that not in perfect flesh, not in a nature like Adam before the fall. No, no. I will take upon myself a sinful nature, but I will trust in my Father's power to enable me to keep the commandments in that sinful flesh. And that's what Jesus did, friend. So why did he do that? Well, he did that to show that God's law could be obeyed through faith in the power of God. But Jesus also did it for this reason, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. Friends, in our flesh, by ourselves, we can't keep anything except keep on sinning. That's all we can do. But we have a choice now. Because Jesus came, because Jesus lived the law of God in our sinful flesh, now we can look to Christ and he can empower us to obey God's commandments. Praise the Lord tonight, friends. We don't have to be slaves to sin anymore. We can be free. We can be free. Jesus came to lift us up, to give us the power to do what we can't do. Desire of Ages, page 324, says, the only defense against evil is the indwelling of Christ in the heart through faith in his righteousness. If we ask Christ every morning to come into our life for that day, and we say, Lord, empower me to follow in your commandments. And when the devil attacks me, I'm going to look to you for strength. And Lord, fill my life with your power. Folk, we have Christ dwelling in us by faith, and his righteousness can keep us against evil. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Titus 2, 11 to 14 says, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from all iniquity. Did Jesus come to save us in our sins? No, he didn't. He didn't come to save us in rebellion against God, in disobedience to the commandments of God. No, Jesus came to enable us to obey the commandments of God, to keep us from all iniquity, and purify unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works. So friend, through faith in the power of a wonderful Savior, Jesus Christ, we can be saved from our sins. Praise God this evening. So the good news about the phrase fear God, God doesn't change his standard. His law doesn't change. No, but God sent somebody to elevate and pick us up so that we could honor God's standard. Praise the Lord, friends. Praise the Lord. In Galatians 3, 21 to 25, the Apostle Paul, he said, is the law against the promises of God? So is exercising faith in God and the Ten Commandments, are they at odds with each other? Paul said, God forbid. He said, meganota, that's impossible. The law and faith are not at odds. They're in harmony. Paul says, if there had been a law given which could have given life, then righteousness should have been by the law. Friends, if we could keep God's law by ourselves, Jesus didn't have to come. He didn't have to come down here and suffer for 31, 33 years. Paul says, if there was a law, if the Ten Commandments can give life, then righteousness would have come by the law. But the fact is that the Ten Commandments cannot give life. They can only give condemnation. That's what the Ten Commandments give, is condemnation. Paul goes on, the Scripture has concluded all under sin, that the promise by faith of Jesus Christ might be given to them that believe. So we don't strive, friends, to follow God's law in our own strength. We strive to focus on Jesus Christ. That's where our battle is, friend. It's not striving to obey. It's striving to look to Jesus, who alone can enable us to obey. Before faith came, we were kept under the law. Paul says, before we exercise faith in Jesus Christ, we can't do anything but sin. We can't do anything else, friend. That's all we can produce is sin. And the law condemns us. And as long as we're in that relationship where we're striving to keep God's law by ourselves, we have never accepted Jesus Christ. Never accepted Christ. But Paul says, before faith came, we were under the law. The law condemned us. Shut up unto the faith which should afterwards be revealed. And then Paul says, the law was our schoolmaster to bring us to Christ. The law points out sin. The law, as James 1 says, is a mirror. It shows defect. It shows where my hair isn't parted. It shows where I have sleep in my eye. It shows where I have a hair hanging over my ear. But that mirror doesn't give me any remedy. It simply points out my defects. It says I have a blackhead right there on my nose. That's what the mirror does, friend. That's what God's law does. It doesn't bring healing. So the law is our schoolmaster. It tells us what we are, and it tells us our terrible condition. But it shows us that so that the Holy Spirit can then come in and say, there is a remedy. There is somebody you can look to. He can empower you. He can help you. And the Holy Spirit brings us to Jesus Christ, that we might be justified by faith. So the Holy Spirit brings us to Christ and says, there's your remedy. There is your solution. There is your Savior and your friend. And then we are justified by faith. After we accept Christ by faith, and He is now my living Savior in my life, does the law still condemn me as a sinner? No, friends, it can't. Because Jesus pardoned me. And Jesus is now my living Savior. So I'm no longer under the condemnation of a schoolmaster. He can't condemn me while I am looking to, trusting in, and leaning on the mighty arm of Jesus Christ. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Testimonies to Ministers, page 456. It says, what is justification by faith? That was the great question Luther asked, the Apostle Paul asked, John Wesley and Charles Wesley asked, William Miller asked. So what is justification by faith? It's the work of God in laying the glory of man in the dust and doing for man that which it is not in his power to do for himself. You know, friends, it's okay to say, I'm helpless. It's okay to say, I am weak. It is okay to say, I can't do anything good of myself. It's okay. Because if we've come to that place, God has laid our glory in the dust. And we recognize our absolute need for Jesus Christ. And when we come to that place, friend, where our glory is in the dust, God then steps in and does for us what we do not have power to do in ourselves. What did the Apostle Paul say? He said, therefore I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in necessities, and in persecutions for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then am I strong. It's not when we're strong that we're strong. It's not when we think we're a big shot that we're strong. No, friend. It's when we're weak that we're strong. Because now it's no longer I, but Christ who dwells in me. So in the first phrase in the three angels' messages to fear God, God elevates the standard of His law and in so doing lays our glory in the dust so that we will look to Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. How about the next phrase? Well, let's see. The first phrase means to turn from evil and keep God's commands. That's what it means to fear God. This phrase exalts Christ as man's only hope for forgiveness and power to live the law of God. Well, how about the next phrase? The next phrase says to fear God and give glory to Him. Well, what does that phrase mean? Well, let's notice some Bible passages. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 31. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 31, the Bible says, "Whether therefore ye eat or drink or whatsoever ye do, do all to the glory of God." Now remember, our phrase here is giving glory to God. So how do we give glory to God? Well, by the health principles that we practice. What we eat, what we drink, whatever we do. By the health principles we practice, we either give glory to God or we make God sad. From this passage, it's clear that by the health principles we follow, we give glory to God. Pretty simple, isn't it? You know, this is so exciting because we don't need Joel Osteen or Joyce Myers or T.D. Jakes or Franklin or Billy Graham or some doctor of theology to tell us what the Bible means. We don't need that because the Bible will tell us if we'll simply listen. Giving glory to Him, following health principles. 1 Corinthians 6, 19 and 20 says, "What, don't you know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which ye have of God, and ye are not your own? For ye are bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God." Well, that's that first angel's message again, isn't it? Giving glory to God. Glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. Well, obviously, folk, from these first two passages, the phrase give glory to Him, it's connected with health, isn't it? With keeping ourselves healthy and strong. Now, what did the Apostle Paul say further to the Corinthians in 1 Corinthians 9, 24 to 27? He said, "Don't you know ye not that they which run in a race run all, but one receives the prize?" Like this guy right here. You know what his name is? Anybody know what this guy's name is? He's won more gold medals.
He's a swimmer.
What's that?
He's a swimmer,
Mike. That's right. He's a swimmer. Michael Phelps. That's it, Marcia. Michael Phelps. That's correct. Won all these medals. But you know, in the races that Michael Phelps won, he's the only one that won the gold. He's the only one. But did other people train just as hard as he did? Yeah, they did. But he's the one who won the gold. And he's the one who took home the wreath. We'll notice his program in a minute. But the Apostle Paul said, in races in the world, everybody runs, but only one gets the prize. Paul said, so run that you may obtain. Every man that strives for the mastery is temperate in all things. They do it to obtain a corruptible crown, but we an incorruptible. You know what this guy, Michael Phelps, does for one of these little pieces of gold? That he in turn, you know what he does? He hangs them on nails in a room in his mother's house. And you know what you have to do about every 4 months or so? Somebody's got to go in there with your spray, and you got to spray off all the dust. You know what he does for that privilege of cleaning them every 3 to 4 months? Trains for 6 hours a day, 6 days a week. 6 hours a day, folks. Even if Christmas Day falls on a training day, he does a full day of training. He swims approximately 50 miles each week. 50 miles? How far is it from here to Bemidji? Jack, how far is it? 18 miles? So Michael Phelps, every week, starts here at your house, swims to Bemidji, swims back, and then swims again. Every week he does that. For what? For what? You tell me, for what? For this? Yeah, for this. Over 8 miles per training day. He has two messages every day, massages every day, and takes ice baths to help his body to recover. You know what, folks? Years ago, my mom sent back to me a box. I think it's when I was still in California. Now, I didn't win gold medals, but I have back home in Florida, I've got, I don't know, probably 15 trophies. Basketball, baseball, maybe football. For what? For what? They sit there on the shelf in our living room. For what? Just so I can get out my spray every so often and spray them off? What a waste. All that time, all that energy, all that focus for something that's going to perish, for something that will pass away. And Paul says they do it to obtain a corruptible crown. We're striving for an incorruptible crown. We're not talking, friends, about a crown that's going to be set on a shelf. No. We're talking about something that will endure forever. Forever. And if these people strive and are temperate in their lives, for a wreath that within a few days is going to just rot, they do it for a corruptible crown. What about us? Do you think we might start taking seriously temperance? Do you think that might start to be more of a focus, friends? We're going after an incorruptible crown. Paul says, I run not uncertainly, I fight not as one that beateth the air. I keep under my body and bring it into subjection, lest that by any means when I have preached to others, I myself should be a castaway. Let's look at something here this evening. In some places, we often look at this word as a bad word. I got this from a book written by a dear friend of mine named Danny Vieira. The benefits, friend, from temperate lives, the benefits are endless. Clear mind, sharp thinking, at peace with ourselves and with our Maker, able to fight off depression and heartache and tragedy and struggle through temperance. Danny writes in his little booklet, he says, my number one depression fighter is exercise. I notice if I miss exercise for a few days, I start to feel depressed. It's like a catch-22. If I miss a few days of exercise, I have little motivation to go to the gym. The Mayo Clinic published a study that was very informative. Exercise has long been touted as a way to maintain physical fitness, prevent high blood pressure, diabetes, and other diseases. You know, it's funny when people will say to me, you know, Bill, I've got high blood pressure and I've got diabetes and I really don't know what to do. And I'll say, well, do you exercise? The conversation's over. They don't want to hear that. What they want to hear is, Bill, can you tell me a good pill that I could take from the doctor? That's what we want to hear today, friends. We want to hear about the next best medication. That's not the answer. It's not the answer. It's getting out and exercising. A growing volume of research shows that exercise can help improve symptoms of certain mental health conditions. Where did Ellen White say 90% of all disease begins? Where did she say it begins? In the mind, Marcia, that's right. In the mind. And what did the Mayo Clinic say? Certain mental health conditions can be improved by exercise, including depression and anxiety. Exercise may also help prevent a relapse after treatment for depression or anxiety. Research suggests it may take at least 30 minutes of exercise a day for at least 3 to 5 days a week to significantly improve depression symptoms. You take out the number of hours that we waste, the amount of hours that we are on the computer, the amount of hours that we're in front of a television set, folk, 3 to 5 days a week, 30 minutes, exercising improves depression symptoms. Smaller amounts of activity, as little as 10 to 15 minutes at a time, can improve mood in the short term. Small bouts of exercise may be a great way to get started if it's initially too hard to do more. You know, it is so wonderful to get out and sweat and exercise. Get your heart rate up. Get your standing heart rate, maybe at your resting heart rate 70. All right? Get out and do an exercise, cardiovascular exercise, so you're getting your heart rate up 130, 140. So you're sweating. And folk, I guarantee you, if you do that 3 to 5 days a week for 30 minutes, you're going to feel so much better. So much better. I'll tell you, folk, I listen to people that when I talk to them on the phone, and it's like, I'm about ready to give up the ghost. This world's just tearing me up. Folk, if we get out, if we'd get out and exercise, we would be ready to face the world. We'd be ready to face the world. Evidence suggests that exercise raises the levels of certain mood-enhancing neurotransmitters in the brain. It may also boost feel-good endorphins, release muscle tension, help you sleep better, reduce levels of stress hormone cortisol. It increases body temperature, which may have calming effects. All of these changes in your mind and body can improve such symptoms as sadness, anxiety, irritability, stress, fatigue, anger, self-doubt, and hopelessness. Do any of us struggle with any of these, friends? If we do, we start exercising, this is going to start to change. Because God has locked into our human mechanism. When we exercise, it relieves these things. Locked into the three angels' messages is the importance of health. We could have looked at a whole lot of other aspects of health. We just looked at exercise this evening. It's part of the messages, but not above it. The need to maintain our body and mind in sound, healthy condition enables us to follow the principles of Jesus and to help others. 2 Peter 1:5-7. We'll close with this evening. In Peter's ladder of Christian growth, I want you to notice something. He says this, beside this, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue. To virtue, knowledge. To knowledge, temperance. There's giving glory to God right there, being temperate. Now, folk, in this ladder of Christian growth, everything is dependent on the previous one. Temperance goes to patience. Patience goes to godliness. Godliness to brotherly kindness. Brotherly kindness to charity. Folk, if we're not temperate, we're not patient. I guarantee it. I remember a guy I worked with 35 years ago. He was very intemperate. He killed himself at his job. He was a very impatient man. They go together. If you're intemperate, you're impatient. If you're intemperate, it's impossible to have godliness. Why? Because you're into this. You're sad all the time. You're anxious. You're irritable. You're stressed out. You're fatigued. You're angry. And you doubt yourself. So, folk, temperance leads to patience. Temperance leads to dependence on Christ, which is godliness. And godliness is brotherly kindness. If we're intemperate, it's impossible to be kind to others. It's impossible. So, friends, the importance of health within the first angel's message, within our lives, is critical for our own personal well-being and our ability to communicate to others the goodness of God. Let us pray. Father in heaven, thank you. Thank you for your love to us. Thank you that you've written your word in such a way that little people can understand it. And it's not something mysterious or magical or mystical, just very plain. We thank you tonight that as a loving Father, you communicate to us that way that we can understand. I just pray, Lord, that you would guide each one of us this evening. Keep us safe as we travel. And Lord, lay our glory in the dust that we will only trust in Christ. And help us to implant these principles of temperance and exercise into our lives. And thank you for the Sabbath that's almost